Your scalp's itchy, inflamed, maybe even raw. And none of the products you've tried seem to be working. And now, maybe your hair's even thinning. Here's the problem, most scalp products aren't treating the right cause, and no one's really explaining what that is. And a lot of scalp products, well, they actually make things worse. I'm Michelle, chemistry PhD cosmetic science nerd, and I used to scratch my scalp raw. It took me years of going through the research and trying different products before I worked out what was really going on. So in this video, I'll break down the real science behind itchy scalp and how to fix it for good. There are three major causes of itchy scalp we need to understand, and they all need to be treated differently. If you miss one, a product might work for a while, but then your scalp just gets itchy again. Cause one is microbes. Now, you might be thinking, I've heard Malassezia yeast causes dandruff, but my scalp's just itchy. I don't have flakes. But this is still important. It's one of the most misunderstood causes of itchy scalp. You see, Malassezia is on everyone's scalp, and this is a good thing when everything is balanced. Just don't think too hard about all of those microbes. It helps keep more harmful microbes in check. But when things are out of balance, when this yeast overgrows, that's when things go wrong. The problem comes from Malassezia microbes interacting with sebum, which are the oils naturally on your scalp. It feeds off this oil and turns it into a bunch of irritating substances. These make your scalp inflamed and itchy. And this happens even if you don't see any dandruff flakes. In this study, inflammatory markers rose after 3 days and people reported itching, but it took 3 weeks to start seeing more flakes. So a lot of people don't realize these microbes are a big part of their problem. This was me, I was hovering in this sort of itchy region, but it wasn't quite at the flake stage, so I thought dandruff products just weren't for me. And a lot of other scalp products actually feed this yeast, so I was making things worse without even realizing it.
But just tackling the microbes usually isn't enough. You also need to understand dry scalp.
Your scalp is skin. There's a whole bunch of hair and extra oil, but it still has the skin barrier structure, and it's still more comfortable when it's the right level of moisturized. If you use really harsh products that strip your scalp too much, it can dry out and feel itchy and tight, just like the skin on your face and body. If you're a skincare nerd, you might already know, the wrong cleanser can really mess up your skin. I talk about this in my other videos and my skincare ebook. From a formulation point of view, a shampoo is just a special type of cleanser. If you use the wrong shampoo, the cleaning ingredients, the surfactants, they can stay in your scalp after rinsing and mess up your barrier. It gets leaky, it lets out water more easily, and it lets irritants in more easily as well, so you get itchy. And some of your habits might dry it out even more. If you use really hot water in the shower, or you use a really hot blow dryer, or if you just have really dry and cold weather and you use a heater, all of this can dry out your scalp. Hormones can also be a big part of this, and this can still be an issue if your scalp is oily. You might have heard that oily skin can still benefit from moisturizer if it's losing too much water. You end up in this oily but dry situation, you have too much oil, but that oil is not keeping the water in your skin. The exact same thing can happen with your scalp. So you might already see the big problems we have here. If your scalp issues are caused by these dandruff microbes, but you think it's dry scalp, then you might wash your hair less, you might put oils on your scalp, but these will actually make the microbes grow more and your itching gets worse. If you're using an anti-dandruff shampoo at the same time, it might seem like it's not helping and you give up on it, thinking it might not be either of these, it might be some secret third issue.
Foreshadowing.
So you really need to work out which of these apply to you. This microbe situation is more common, and it's even more likely to be this if you've ever had dandruff before. About half the population is prone to dandruff, and we're more likely to have an itchy scalp. Also, if your scalp and skin is generally oily, if you don't wash your hair that much, if you live somewhere humid, this is probably part of your problem. But if you've never had dandruff and none of your relatives have, genetic susceptibility is a big part of dandruff, your skin is very dry, you might even have eczema, and you wash and dry your hair regularly, then you might be in the less common situation where dry scalp is an issue, but not the microbes. But if you have this microbe situation, you probably also have dry scalp, because these substances from the microbes, they will actually make your scalp barrier more leaky. And a lot of dandruff treatments also dry out your scalp. So this becomes a bit of a vicious cycle.
I didn't really make this connection until I got deep into researching my book, The Science of Beauty. If you're finding this video helpful, check it out. As well as hair, it covers skin, nails, and makeup.
Luckily, there are lots of products and chips that work for both of these without making the other one worse. But before we can talk about products, we need to look at the last piece of the puzzle, potential allergens.
Because if you're allergic to something that you're using, you can still itch even when the other problems are fixed. And there is a really common allergen in shampoos, and that is the main product type for dealing with scalp issues. Here is a cosmetic chemist insider tip. Wash off products like shampoos. They are formulated differently from leave-on products. Wash-off products don't stay on your skin for long, so it's safe to put higher levels of ingredients in them, and this is generally fine, except for allergens if you're allergic to them. I really need to stress this. If you aren't allergic to an ingredient, you do not need to avoid it. Allergies are when your immune system overreacts to something that is normally safe. I'm allergic to cats. That doesn't mean everyone needs to avoid cats. But sometimes if your scalp is itchy after you use particular products, that can be a sign of an allergy that you haven't discovered yet. The two big ones are MI and MCI. These are even nicknamed the itchy M's. These are preservatives that became more common after brands started getting rid of parabens because of misinterpreted research. It was mostly for marketing purposes. But parabens are actually super safe, very few people are allergic to them, and brands still needed preservatives because products will go moldy. So MI and MCI started getting more popular, even though they weren't researched as much, and it turns out a lot more people are allergic to them. When I looked this up in PubMed, I found 23 articles with the word epidemic in the title. This is very strong language for science papers. These were suddenly the second most common allergen after nickel. Again, if you're not allergic, these are not a problem, but it's estimated that at least a few percent of the population are allergic to these, including me. And the most annoying part, these are really common in scalp products. It's gotten better, but I found MI or MCI in all of these shampoos, specifically claiming to help itchy scalp. So if you didn't know you were allergic, these might actually make your scalp itchier. There's a related preservative that's super common in liquid laundry detergents, so if your clothes make you itchy sometimes, there is a good chance you're also allergic to MI and MCI. Here are some other common allergens. If a lot of shampoos make you mysteriously itchy, you might want to look into these. The most reliable way to check is patch testing with a medical doctor, but if you keep track of shampoos and products that do and don't make you itchy, you might see some patterns. There are other causes, but these three are the most likely. If itchy scalp is something you've had for a long time and there's no rashes or other obvious things suddenly changing. If you do have those, go see a doctor. Now that we know the big causes of itchy scalp and how to work out which ones you have, let's talk about fixing it. First, microbes. Here is the big takeaway. You don't need to have dandruff to benefit from anti-dandruff products. I think a lot of people overlook them because they don't have flakes. And for some weird reason, the sensitive scalp products usually aren't near the anti-dandruff products.
There are four heavy-hitting ingredients that control malassezia, and they're mostly in shampoos as well as some serums. Disclaimer, I've done sponsored posts in the past for some of these products, but I wasn't obliged to include them here. I'm recommending them because I genuinely think they're good.
Selenium sulfide is orangey-yellow and it smells a bit like rubber, but it's very effective.
Some people don't mind the smell, but my nose is super sensitive to sulfur. I worked with it a lot in the lab.
The best smelling ones I've tried are the Dercos Anti-Dandruff DS shampoos. To me, Selsun Blue's fragrance is just a bit too strong.
Zinc pyrithione is another big one. Head & Shoulders pioneered a lot of its use.
It works really well. The main downside is that it's insoluble. The tiny particles can make your hair feel a bit gritty.
It was recently banned in the EU, even though it was found to be safe at under 1%, and that means that it should still not be harmful at 100%. I talk more about safety assessments in this video.
This is an EU regulations quirk. Ingredients that have specific health effects get banned just in case, but it is still available in other countries.
Pyroctone-olamine is a new ingredient that's getting more popular, and this one is really nice because it's soluble, it doesn't smell, so shampoos with it look and feel just like normal shampoos.
I was actually using one for ages without realizing, the Sano Scalp Refresh, and I was amazed that I could go 3 days without feeling itchy. Usually it's just a day.
Sometimes it's actually less because my scalp is just super fussy.
Pyroctone-olamine is in tons of shampoos now, you have a massive range of options. I found it in so many scalp products, even some that didn't say dandruff. The Head & Shoulders Bare Range might be a good option if you think you have an allergy. These have less ingredients. There's also ketoconazole. This is antifungal and it's a nizoral. Climbazole is the weaker cosmetic version.
There are some Malassezia species that are resistant to it, so if this isn't working for you, maybe try one of the other actives. Also, the other three are more broadly antimicrobial, so if you have, say, scalp acne, those can also help with that.
Some other ingredients for dandruff aren't as effective for controlling Malassezia, but they can help with other aspects like flakes or soothing your scalp. Look carefully at the ingredient list to check what you're getting.
Now, some common mistakes with anti-dandruff shampoos. Number one, the microbes are on your scalp and mostly inside the hair follicles, so focus on massaging it all over your scalp. Number two, follow the instructions on the bottle. There's a common myth that these shampoos work better if you leave them for a few minutes, but this only works for some shampoos. Other shampoos have the active ingredients in little bubbles called coacervates. They only release the actives when you dilute it when you're rinsing. So leaving these ones on your scalp for longer, you might just be making your scalp dry and itchy for no good reason. If you use a conditioner on your scalp afterwards, you'll actually wash away some of the actives. So either keep the conditioner under your ears or condition with an anti-dandruff conditioner. Shampooing regularly usually works better for itchy scalp. If you're using anti-dandruff shampoo, that means you are putting more of the active onto your scalp, but on top of that, you're also getting rid of the oils and the microbes.
You can also get anti-dandruff ingredients in serums. These are great between washes, although they don't really replace a proper wash. Most of these have pyrethionolamine. There's also some with zinc pyrethione.
Another thing worth thinking about if microbes are your problem is moisture. This can make it easier for the microbes to multiply.
It's a good idea to dry the hair around your scalp faster. Use a hairdryer rather than leaving it to air dry, especially if it's cold or humid.
But to protect the scalp barrier, don't have this too hot.
My hairdryer has a special scalp mode that's the perfect temperature, but hopefully your hairdryer has a setting that feels comfortable. If it's too hot, move it further away. Hats and helmets can also trap moisture and make things worse, especially when you're sweaty. Try to have some airflow in there and wash your hair soon after you sweat. Now onto some things for dry scalp, which are also important for microbes.
Remember, the microbes produce irritants which lead to a leaky scalp barrier. And this first point is especially important, gentle shampoo. You want something that won't make your scalp feel stripped because it's drying out your barrier, it's also making it easier for these irritating substances to get in and cause itching. Again, like with your face skin, you don't want to use anything that's too harsh. In general, a slightly acidic, skin-friendly pH is better for your scalp, somewhere between like 4 and 7. pH isn't that important for your hair, which is another whole mess we need to talk about in a different video. Also, avoid using conditioner on your scalp. The surfactants in conditioners are actually more irritating than the ones in shampoo. The hair near your scalp is nice and undamaged. It doesn't really need conditioning. Antioxidants. They're a really safe option. They're great for protecting against irritation and improving your scalp condition. And the way that these Malassezia microbes make these irritating substances, it's through oxidation, so they can also help with that. Some studies show antioxidants can reduce hair shedding, which makes a lot of sense. Your scalp is where your hair grows, and oxidative stress is thought to be a contributor to hair loss.
The Dercos Serum 10 is the one I've used the most. It has pyrethionolamine as well as a bunch of antioxidants and centella, which is soothing. I also really like this nozzle, which makes it super easy to apply, and it doesn't leave any sort of stickiness or weighing down. After it dries, I can't tell I've used anything.
There are tons of scalp products with antioxidants. Just make sure they don't have oils in them if microbes are an issue. Your tap water can be a big issue in some places, especially hard water. This is when there's metal ions dissolved in the water and you might be able to see chalky water stains and build up around your taps. Hard water can be really irritating. It can make your hair feel like there's a film on it. Some metal ions can also speed up oxidation. The best solution is a whole house water softening system, but there are also inline softeners you can get just for your shower. Filters usually get rid of chlorine, but not hard water ions, so make sure you check what exactly the product is going to do. There are some products you really want to be careful with if microbes are part of your problem, and the main thing is oils. Most oils aren't actually that good at sealing in water. Malassezia feed on oils and makes them grow faster, and they turn it into those irritating substances. So I would recommend avoiding plant oils in any sort of leave-on scalp products. Some people do find oils helpful, but I think it's mostly the massaging. Massaging anything can help get residue off the scalp, especially for people who use a lot of product and don't wash their hair that often. If you're in this category and you think you might have this micro problem, maybe try massaging a serum that has anti-dandruff ingredients instead of an oil. Dry shampoo, this can be helpful for soaking up oil and removing some of those irritants, but it can't really replace actual shampoo. A lot of people who are using dry shampoo should really just be washing their hair more. Spraying a dry shampoo too close to your scalp can also be drying and irritating. Scalp scrubs and brushes, this is really personal preference, but I personally don't find them very helpful for my hair type and routine. I find it pretty hard to get the scrub through my hair. I feel like it's mostly just scrubbing my hair, which is damage I don't really need. I don't mind brushes, but I have nails and that just works much better for me. Chemical exfoliants is similar. It might be helpful if you have a lot of buildup, but I wash my hair almost every day and I don't use much product, so that just hasn't made much difference. If you thought about trying rosemary oil, I would recommend against it. This video has more on why. If you're wondering about dry hair, I have a video all about hair and hydration. My hair science playlist is here. Let me know what else you're wondering about. See you in the next video.